Good morning, Christian friends. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's such a blessing to be here this morning and to see you wonderful people. I know I miss what is happening now. I feel really blessed and thankful to be here this morning to share God's word. Let us now listen to Gary as he blesses us in a message and a song.
Feeling love, for we have put
your trust and faith in you. O Lord, I will always sing of your constant love. I will proclaim your faithfulness forever. Kindly be seated. Friends, I invite you to join with me in a fellowship of prayer. Let us pray. Precious and beloved Father, we stand in your awesome presence this morning and we give you all the honor and praise we deserve. We glorify and magnify you, O Lord, because you are our treasure. You are the precious jewel that we seek, O Lord. You are our all in all. O Father, receive our adoration for you with a quiet this morning and fill us with your Holy Spirit, which enables us to live according to your will. Lord, you are the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, and we just want to give you the best worship today and always. Lord, your goodness and faithfulness is beyond our comprehension. So we just want to thank you and praise you. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us take up our song sheet and lift our voices in song as we sing. Hymn number 324. For those who are living for praise, great is thy faithfulness. confess our sins. Merciful God, we recognize our unworthiness. Forgive us, O Father, and help us to mend our ways. Lord, at times we have been careless to listen. We have been hungry, we have hurt others. Forgive us, O God. Loving Father, forgive us for the times that we were very in service to you, for our disobedience, for our lack of faith, and all our shortcomings. Send your purifying spirit into all of our hearts and guide us to righteous living. May we be ever grateful for the precious blood that cleanses us from our sins, O Lord. We thank you for your saving grace. Lord, may we be delivered by your goodness and mercy. Precious Father, with hearts of gratitude for your many blessings, we thank you. For health and strength, for all the comforts and joys of life that we experience, we are eternally grateful. We thank you for answered prayers and the healing of our loved ones. Lord, we are grateful for your amazing power and goodness in our lives. We thank you for your unconditional love that graces us each day. But most of all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul tells us, you should each give, then as you have decided, not with regret or out of sense of duty, for God loves a cheerful giver. This morning's offering will not be received for the work and business of the church.
Lord, it's your name.
his gifts to you in hope. A hope which brings here and now, yet stretches further than the human eye can see. May our daily fruit reflect our worship here, so that in our giving, all your people's love may be your kingdom's aim. Bless, sanctify, and multiply these tokens, and use them for the advancement of your kingdom here and earth. Bless us and use us as channels of your love and the goodness. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, with thanksgiving. Amen. Good morning, Christian friends. On behalf of our minister, Reverend Indra Kukura, the chairman, Curtis, Mr. Curtis Speaker, and members of our local board, I welcome you all to our service this morning. Today I have the pleasure of welcoming our leader of worship, Mrs. Wendy Gatchra, who was a former primary school principal. Mrs. Gatchra is currently a member of the Presbyterian Primary School Board. And another at the Valley Presbyterian Church. We welcome you and look forward to your message. The following are the notices. With respect to the COVID-19 virus, the guidelines from the Ministry of Health and PCTT still stands. They are to be followed very closely, especially with the rapidly increasing new cases being identified daily. As we adjust to the new normal, we should pay careful attention to the following guidelines. Social distancing at least 6 feet apart from other members of the congregation. Continue to wear your mask. Wash your hands with soap and water for at least 20 seconds or use the hand sanitizers provided at the different locations on the compound. Cough or sneeze into a tissue or the crook of your elbow. Use your personal handbooks and Bibles. We will continue to record your attendance and body temperature as you enter the church. There will be no Sunday school until further notice. Parents and children of the Sunday school can visit our Sunday school page for Bible stories, songs, memory verses, and Bible story craft videos. You can also communicate with us by sending us an email at knoxpresbyteriansundayschool@gmail.com. There is a vacancy for a cleaner at the Milton Presbyterian Primary School and a cafeteria operator at the Carney Presbyterian given the four walls, what do we have to offer the world? Please note that only one offer will be taken up on this week. Congratulations to Mr. Anand Sankar Singh on his appointment as a board member of the St. Andrew's Theological College. Registration is now open for our 2020 Elders Training Course. The details of the course are as follows. Start date, Saturday 12 September, time 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m., duration 6 weeks, end date October 17, 2020, location St. Andrew's Theological College. You can also have the option to attend classes via Zoom. The cost is $500. The deadline for payment, Friday, 20th August, 2020. The following is a letter from the Presbyterian Church of Trinidad and Tobago. To all workers, to all church workers, presbyteries, clerk of sessions, regarding PCTT operations, update on COVID-19 pandemic. Greetings in the name of Christ. With the surge of COVID-19 cases in the last few weeks, pastoral regions have expressed grave concern regarding the well-being of its members and the wider community. While the PCTT and every citizen must take the necessary precautions, we must not create unnecessary panic by making unilateral decisions, but encourage discipline and cautious behavior. Some of the main hallmarks of Presbyterianism are order and discipline. And if we fail to practice such then, we will lose an important part of our identity. We must guard against actions that take away from the consultative and consensus approach. If any congregation is directly affected with positive COVID-19 cases and need to take measures to ensure the health and safety of its members, it is advisable and wise for the local board to do so in consultation with the session, taken from the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. For those who have their Bibles, Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. And I now invite Christopher to read the scripture.
Good morning, everyone. Our scripture reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. This portion of scripture is entitled Faith. To have faith is to be sure of the things we hope for, to be certain of the things we can't see. It was by their faith that people of ancient times won God's approval. It is by faith that we understand that the universe was created by God's will, so that what can be seen was made out of what can't be seen. It was faith that made Abel offer to God a better sacrifice than Cain's. Through this faith, he won God's approval as a righteous man, because God himself approved of his gifts. By means of his faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. It was faith that he kept Enoch from dying. Instead, he was taken up to God, and no one could find him, because God had taken him up. The scripture says that before Enoch was taken up, he had pleased God. No one can please God without faith, for whoever comes to God must have faith that God exists and rewards those who seek him. It was faith that made Noah hear God's warning about things in the future that he could not see. He obeyed God and built a boat in which he and his family were saved. As a result, the world was condemned, and Noah received from God the righteousness that comes by faith. It was faith that made Abraham obey when God called him to go out to a country which God had promised to give him. He left his own country knowing where he was going. By faith, he lived as a foreigner in the country that God has promised him. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who received the same promise from God. For Abraham was waiting for a city which God has designed and built, the city with permanent foundations. It was faith that made Abraham able to become a father, even though he was too old and Sarah herself could not have children. He trusted God to keep his promise. This is the word of God.
All my days, I'm in your hands.
is willing. That song tells us everything of God's goodness, of His faithfulness. We are really blessed this morning. I invite you to bow in prayer. Holy and precious Lord, wrap us in your tender arms and let our worship empower our souls with the beauty of your love. We worship your name and praise. We possess. We must understand that where we are now, it didn't happen on our own. It wasn't our education, our talent, our good looks, but the hand of God that blesses us. God has been working behind the scenes, just lighting up our lives with His goodness. You are blessed with wisdom. God has given us wisdom. He has given us success. Some can sing, some can dance. Good health was the goal. But where did we get these? It came from our Father above. So let us remember to thank God for all His goodness and for taking us places where we probably never imagined that we could reach. When we reflect on God's faithfulness, we must recognize that many times He protected us, healed us, favored us, and let us not take it for granted. Let us be grateful. The morning when we get up, who is it? Thank you, Jesus, I'm alive. Let us thank Him for the many opportunities, the many doors He has opened. Let us first seek the kingdom of God. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, remember how God brought the Israelites to the promised land, the land of abundance. He told them, do not forget the Lord your God who rescued you from slavery and led you out of the wilderness. It is really amazing what God has done for the Israelites. He led them to the land where they will lack nothing. God's favor was upon them, just as His favor is upon us. You know, with a few months of lockdown before, some of us vented in frustration. And that is a normal thing, right? We are human, as we say. But can you fathom being in bondage for 40 years? Locked away for 40 years and hatchets? We are very good. I wouldn't say lucky, but we are very blessed. That is all because of God. So friends, you should never grow weary of thanking God for His goodness and know that He has a greater plan for us amidst all this. Now, another lockdown, so to speak, is forthcoming. Or I would say it's already here. As you would have heard, from tomorrow, we have to follow certain guidelines. Church is one of them. From next week, we not have church, but luckily, or I should say, God has provided us the technology to go and stream online, and it will be less than half of many. So that's a positive side, you know. So let us just hold on to our faith and hold on to God. All we have heard this account of Jesus feeding 5,000, and this is mentioned in four Gospels. I believe because it is mentioned in four Gospels, it is immensely important, that miracle that shows God's goodness. Jesus took 5 loaves and 2 fish, and looking up towards heaven, He blessed the food and it fed multitudes. You see, Jesus unlocked that door of goodness. So, friends, I am sure you are thankful for the food that is on your table today. And that you can share with someone, your neighbor, your friend, those who are in need. So I just wanted to point out what was good then, and He is doing good now. That He has been provided for us. He is Jehovah Jireh, God our provider. There have been times in our lives in which we would have had setbacks. But after allowing the time to pass and things get sorted out, we were able to see that God was actually taking us out, probably out of the way of harm, danger that could have befallen us. I remember clearly 2 years ago, I felt, actually I was racing in and out the house just to be on time for quiet practice. And I fell down in my garage. I chipped it over my ankle. I also tore two ligaments, you know, without using crutches and I can do a long, you know, lengthy therapy and so on. But you know what? I trust the goal. But it's healing, and I'm sure that today I can stand here and say he prevented me from probably getting into something more severe. So, you know, I must stand by praise God for that. So, you know, just take your worries, take your troubles to God. Mark 10 verse 18 says, no one is good but one. And that's God. That is kind of scripture. God's goodness hinges on what he does for us. We often wonder about his bountiful blessings upon us, his mercy, his steadfast love, his kindness. No matter where you find yourself in life, there could be a negative too. Maybe you have to step out of church. Something can happen. That's the way of life. Something didn't go your way. But you know what? Jesus, in his goodness, will turn it around and something positive will really come. And we are believers of God. And we must trust him. So friends, God has worked many miracles in your life, as I said, and in my life. And sometimes we must focus our thoughts and attention on God instead of things of the world. Not get sidetracked. Because God, in his goodness and through his presence, offered us his salvation so that we could live eternally with him. He has revealed himself, and to him we give all the glory. Now, God does not just stay on his throne and say, I am good. You receive his goodness through many actions. Have you ever prayed for a miracle and you have received it? Did you ever take time to give testimony to God for what he has done? Or are we hesitant at times? Can I say someone is going up the coffee and say, okay, this is what God has done for me? I'm sure many of you. Because I remember in Bible class when Reverend Pooram asked us to give a testimony. Everybody was overjoyed, certainly expressed their faithfulness, and they gave testimonies. Now, just come up, but I have given this testimony about what God had done for me. And this happened one morning. I was up early getting ready for the National Presbyterian Convention. I realized that my left eye, I just could not see anything. There was a clot. I had a clot in my eye. I don't know, I didn't know. I just was, you know, I had some cold, so I just washed off my left eye and I opened it up and looked out to see, you know, what was happening. I'm not seeing in my left eye. What is going on here? I saw just the shadow of the mango tree, no leaves. So you can imagine, they were starting to pray, this is going on. Well, I got an appointment by the miracle. I would say that is what Jesus did. I got an appointment with Dr. Mitchell, he's the ophthalmologist in Port Fair, very old guy. And he looked at it, he said, you know what? Laser surgery, just like that, all the blues. I said, okay. Went home, again, trusted God, I prayed and prayed. And then a few days later, he asked me to come up and then he checked. There was no blood in my eye. Thanks God, thank you Jesus for that. There are something in my life right now. I testified to that. And you know what? The doctor just said, I did not charge you any money for this visit. Because you know what? God has performed a miracle for you. 2 Corinthians 1, verse 20 tells us that every one of God's promises is yes. That means all the good and perfect gifts of God comes through our relationship with Jesus. So if you want to understand and appreciate God's goodness, you can begin with Jesus and also end with Jesus. We must be ever grateful for his goodness. See his hands of generosity as he continues to bless us, as he continues to protect us and to keep us safe. God has goodness stored up in you. Just ask and you will receive. Now I want to look at faith, God's faith for this time. I want to look at living a faith-filled life, walking in faith. So Hebrew chapter 11, that was read by Christopher just a while ago, verses 1 to 11, gives a very good account of faith. You know, this recording is about different Bible people and their faiths in God. Hebrews 11:1, the King James Version says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." The Good News Version tells us, "To have faith is to be sure of the things we hope for, to be certain of the things we cannot see." You know, that those statements came from the Bible. Those in the scripture. Though we do not see, yet we must believe will be done. And that is faith, having faith. Just as our physical eyesight is the sense that gives us evidence of the material world, faith is the sense that gives us evidence of the invisible spiritual world, so to speak. Hebrews 11, verse 1 to 11, speaks about the faith of the people who held on to God. For example, Noah was mentioned. Noah was a man of amazing faith. He heeded God's instructions and warnings. Imagine living in a desert. No rain. Probably not in a rainbow. And Noah was instructed to build an ark of such a great magnitude. You know that story, right? But people probably asked him, why was Noah building this ark? But he was obedient. You know, sometimes we must just sit back or lie down, whatever, wherever you are, and just listen to God's voice. Listen to him and obey him. And through listening and obedience, our faith will be increased. So, Noah saw faith through the lens of faith and was divinely granted safety, right, for him and his family. So, obeying God means that you're going to believe and do what he has instructed. Sometimes the world will understand that. You know how many people can say, Noah probably mad. You know why he's building this big ark out of wood? No rain. Where is that all coming from? But he trusted God, he was obedient. So let us be encouraged by Noah's life. Now I want to speak about Abraham a little bit here. It was mentioned in Hebrews. And sometimes Abraham is called the father of faith. Some of you might have heard some references. Abraham being called the father of faith. In Genesis 12, we see Abraham's faith. The Lord said to Abraham, "Leave your country, leave your relatives, and your father's home, and go to a land that I am going to show you." When Abraham was 75 years old, he left his country with his wife Sarah and his nephew Lot. At 75 years, you are settled in our country, where is your dad? And at 75 years, you think that you already have that faith and that somebody who wants to come to this, let's go to Miami and settle there. Leave everything you have, you can have, leave everything. Leave everything here. Leave locks, probably go to the next church here. Oh, you think you're ready? You don't have to think about that, right? It's a big decision. But I really am Abraham faith was very great. He left his country and went to unknown land. See, you know what will happen there, right? But God promised him. Remember in those days they worshipped idols. And Haran, right? And God is coming and instructed him to go to a different land. But you see, Abraham was walking in faith and obedience. Although he was probably confused, he acted and obeyed God. It took many years, probably just uncle to God. He had this special relationship with him. I could go remember when he was also tested and he had a prophet with his son in Mount Moriah, and his faith was also tested here. But God, there was a lamb in the bushes and that lamb was offered as a sacrifice. So Abraham did not have to sacrifice his son again. And remember they were in their old age when they had Isaac. But I will go more into it in that words. What I'm trying to say is that he held on to his faith in God. And God was good to him. Friends, this morning, I want to explore you that whatever God promises you, you just believe in it. Believe in his written word and those that he has spoken to your heart. Obey what he has revealed to you. Do not fear God's promises. Do not fear the direction that he's leading you. Sometimes we become confident, but just allow God to do things in your life. Trust him, serve him with adoration, and keep your feet. I just want to go back to Hebrews 11, verse 6, that tells us, no one can please God without faith. For whoever comes to God and must have faith that exists, and God rewards those who seek him. You know, all we have to do is to seek our God, to call on him, to exercise faith, and all your promises will be received and will be given. Do you believe that? Amen. The book of Hebrews boldly proclaims the superiority of Jesus and shows how faith is pleasing to God. That chapter tells us all about faith. God's greatest promise, you know, we mentioned before, is salvation, right? And you know that eternal life is waiting for us because we believe and we trust and we have faith in God. That is his promise. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, for whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Now let us look at the First Samuel chapter 17. Remember David and Goliath? Now, remember David was a shepherd boy. He was not a warrior. But he saw Goliath mocking God's people. David approached the king and asked to fight Goliath. Little boy, shepherd boy, big giant. But David's ability, David's faith in God was not shaken at all. And he defeated Goliath because of his faith. Delivered the people. So sometimes it may seem hard to place our faith in one that we cannot see. So you know what? That is why we need the Word of God. We need the Scripture. We just live in the Word. Read our Bible and read. The Bible speaks of many testimonies about God's power and God's faithfulness. That is what we need to find it. And you know, we have our lockdown coming up. Well, we are on a lockdown already. So, friends, I encourage you to go to the Bible, read it, read about God's faithfulness. Increase your faith to the Word. Let it speak into your hearts. Right? You may not be able to see, but you can feel God's power. Now, at times our faith dims. We can think of many circumstances that we may feel God is too difficult for God to handle. But I want to read a verse from Mark 9, what God says. Everything is possible for a person who has faith. Jesus said everything is possible. And you know what? I cannot really emphasize that enough. So, friends, we can go exercise our faith and go boldly to God time, was speaking the, to this, and then Captain mentioned also, talking about the rapid increase of this virus in Trinidad in particular. Not speaking about the other countries, because you know what it is like. Now, there are also deaths, two more deaths, am I correct? Right. Now, some of us might be saying, I am afraid of contagion for you. You think people say that? Yes? Okay, that's true. They are. Going to the supermarket, the next issue, visiting relatives, we're not taking care of visiting relatives, and, as we are customary going. And also the friends living outside, those who have to go. Now we have to adjust to the new normal. Wearing our masks as we are doing now. Washing your hands, as we never did before. Sanitizing the mind. Adhering to all protocols we are doing that, right? So, now friends, I am not saying you will lose things. But just remember, God is still good. And you know what? He will continue to bless you. He will continue to protect you. All you have to do is not let your faith shake you. Psalm 16 verse 8 says, I accept the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Another version says, I will not be shaken. I will remain full. Trust the Lord, friends. Trust him as your champion, your protector, your leader, your example. Do not fear, my friends. Follow your protocols, but do not fear. Today, you are come to church with faith. Faith of receiving the word. And faith of receiving the message. Thank God for that. Now with the new regulations, you may have to revert some online services as we just mentioned. But you know what? In the midst of all this, just don't let that fear creep into your thoughts and into your mind. Don't let it take control of you. God is your keeper. He will never leave you and he will never forsake you. He's our preserver. And he will rescue you. Just run to him, like the song says. Run after Jesus. Christian friends, as I close, just want to close with just to give you some courage. When you believe that God is good all the time, he will do miracles in your life. Just listen to his voice. Obey. He will deliver you from all challenges that you are facing. This will free you and you can take giant leaps of faith. Just listen to his instruction. God's goodness and your faith in him, it will open supernatural doors. Psalm 107 tells us, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Just keep believing, keep trusting, keep obeying. And just listen to the voice of God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. That's it. On the 20th of August, the student will be rising, let's see. And you know how many challenges these kids really had for the past months going on. Parents have started with teachers, principals. So, in my pastoral prayer, I have a special prayer that I would like to say. And you will please pray with me and pray for these children. So, let us bow our heads and pray. Loving God, we come before you with thankful hearts. For your word read and proclaimed, we thank you. Lord God, lay your mighty hands upon us. Let your voice say, all is well, fear not. Come and give rest to your children. Remove from us any burdens that make our hearts heavy at this time. Let your light shine on us as we face uncertainty in these perilous times. Only you, Lord, know our heart's desire. O God, enable us to continue to obey, trust in you, and to hold on to our faith. Empower us to speak life-giving words to those who are discouraged and hopeless. O Lord, mighty God, be with our leaders and guide their decisions to make our nation a better place. Heal our land from divide and discrimination. Let us live in unity, love, and peace, O God. Lord, you are the great physician. We pray that your healing power be upon those who are affected by this pandemic and other illnesses. Precious Father, inspire those who are seeking a vaccine for this virus to make a breakthrough soon, Lord, so that the spread will be eliminated. Precious Jesus, you are the fountain of wisdom and encouragement. We ask you to bless all the students who will be writing the SBA exam on August 20th. Grant them the ability to recall what they have learned. Grant them the abundant grace to express themselves and enable them to be focused on the examination. We ask you to remove all anxiety and fear from their hearts and give unto them this calm spirit. Lord, let them find favor with the examination and guide them as they use their knowledge and skills too. Bundle up these little ones in your hands and let them go with faith and confidence as they answer their questions. Lord, hold their hands and be their guide and their son so that they will successfully complete the exam. Bless and protect all supervisors, principals, teachers and educators who are assigned the duties to administer and supervise the examination. We ask thee, Lord, to allow the exam to run smoothly without any obstacles. Watch over the parents and bless them as they continue to provide educational opportunities for their children. Lord, we commit the nation's students into your hands. We commit all involved in this examination. O Jesus, come in as your protection over the students, teachers, the principals. Let no harm or danger befall them. We ask these things in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Please let us pray to the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. powers